Good afternoon, and thank you for coming to the Concord Bookshop. This afternoon, we're very pleased to present Dr. Miriam Nelson. She's going to be discussing her new book, Strong Women, Strong Hearts. We have several copies available for sale at the front desk if you're interested in buying it after she finishes speaking. Dr. Nelson is an associate professor at the Friedman School of Nutrition, Science, and Policy at Tufts. And she is also the author of several enormously popular books, including Strong Women Stay Young, Strong Women, Strong Bones, Strong Women and Men Beat Arthritis. And you may have seen her discuss nutrition and exercise on PBS and CNN, Discovery Channel, and I believe Good Morning America as well.
And Oprah.
And Oprah. That's been on the top of the list.
That was
your highlight.
That was fun.
I've heard her speak a couple of times already, and I can assure you she's a very engaging speaker, so please help me welcome Dr. Miriam Nelson.
Thank you so much. It's I speak all over the country, and in fact, in a week I'm headed to Australia to do some work, and the fact that I can basically commute less than a mile and I'm here at my local bookstore is really such a pleasure. And I especially want to thank all of you on Father's Day coming out. I was thinking when I realized about 2 weeks ago that it was Father's Day, I'm thinking, nobody's going to come. But so I really thank you for coming out. With a nonfiction book, you can imagine, although some people say that these are gripping, I would like to do a few readings from the book because I'm very fond of a few passages in the book, but mostly I'd love to just talk a little bit about women and heart disease, nutrition, physical activity, and a couple of other factors that impact heart disease, and then be happy to answer any questions. I'm here for as long as you want me to be. I think that the formal part of this will probably be around 45 minutes long or so, but then feel free, I know that people have some things to do. So what I'd like to do is just start by just doing a couple of readings. The first of which is actually the beginning of the last chapter, It's Your Turn. And this is a quote. It starts out with a quote. If I had known then what I know now, I would have put up much more of a ruckus than I did. And this is from Delinda, who lives in northern Florida. And this is a story that she recounts that happened to her in late 2004. Beginning of 2000, I guess it was beginning of 2004. One night in January, Delinda recounts, I woke in the middle of the night. I just didn't feel right. I was really cold up around my shoulders. I was having trouble breathing. You know when there's just something not right in your body. Delinda's husband started to drive her to the hospital, but she was feeling so poorly that they stopped at the local fire station, and none too soon. Her blood pressure had spiked to 225 over 110, and her pulse rate was 44, too low for someone who's not an athlete. The fire department took Delinda to the emergency room, where the nightmare she was going through began to take on a new dimension. They gave me some blood pressure medication and referred me to my primary care doctor, she said. They just kind of sloughed me off as having an anxiety attack. The next morning, Delinda phoned her doctor, but had to leave a message. When he called back, she was on the line. The voicemail message he left was, I don't have time to play phone tag. Making matters worse still, various medications Delinda's doctors had prescribed to lower her blood pressure weren't working well enough. After a number of feeling sick off-hour visits to the emergency room, she was finally referred to a cardiologist. The cardiologist put her on a new drug that did help, but for almost 2 months, Delinda was too weak to go to work. She's in her early 60s. I was totally out of character. It was totally out of character, her daughter Kim says. My mother's not one to lie around. Delinda then pushed herself to go back to work despite not feeling right. She's the manager of a store in Florida. And then one day in mid-March, she began feeling really funny in my chest. It wasn't horrible pain, it was more of a burning sensation. I started to go to the hospital, it stopped. I went back to work, I thought maybe it's in my head. Then the owner of the company came and said, you don't look good. He drove Delinda to the hospital where she was told she had bronchitis and prescribed an antibiotic. Her pain at that point was coming in waves. One of the nurses thought I had indigestion, Delinda recalls. I told her I didn't. She asked me, do you want to be sick? At 11 o'clock that night, Delinda sat straight up in bed and said to her husband, Andy, I'm dying. She was doubled over. Andy said he'd never seen anyone in so much pain in his life. He got her to the emergency room. where she was made, this is an awful story, I promise it gets much more uplifting after this. He got her to the emergency room, which she was made to wait for an hour and a half, throwing up and moaning and crying in agony until she was finally brought to an examining room. An EKG, finally she had an EKG, showed she was having a massive heart attack. She was then airlifted to a metropolitan hospital where she stopped breathing on the table. They called Code Blue and paged the chaplain, Kim says. Delinda was brought back to life with paddles. One of her main coronary arteries was completely blocked. I'm happy to say she's doing great. She's been in cardiac rehab, but it took months for them to actually take her seriously. And I have to say that this is the reason that Alice Lichtenstein and myself put this book together, because of all the mounting evidence around nutrition, physical activity, but mostly because heart disease in women just isn't being taken very seriously. And we're still in, you know, it's 2005 and this is still happening. Now I'd like to turn just to, so much fun to actually do a couple of quotes from here, but unfortunately what happened to these women is not unique. I have a few quotes in the beginning of the book. Heart disease is considered a man's problem, but every year since 1984, it has killed more women than men in the United States each year. A woman dies from heart disease about once every minute, for an annual total of about 500,000 deaths. There are also lots of women living with heart disease, some 8 million. It has clearly reached a crisis point, one that reflects an unfortunate irony. So much is made of the woman's heart. Women's hearts as symbols of love, purity, emotion, the center of the home. But the female heart can become diseased, and the realness of the heart as giver of life is ignored. So, a couple of other statistics. Whereas 25% of men die within 1 year of their first heart attack, it's 38% of women. 18% of male heart attack survivors experience a second heart attack within 6 years. 35% of women, almost twice the proportion. Women are almost two times as likely as men to die after bypass surgery, and half as likely to get angioplasty to open a narrow blood vessel. I love this quote. We dug back into the literature to try to get some historical perspective around women and heart disease, and so we talk about the tide is shifting, and there's much that's going on right now, especially from the American Heart Association. But here, as recently as 1958, paying attention to women's heart health was such an anomaly that heart disease researchers reporting on one of their studies noted it was the, quote, this is right out of the journal article, quote, the first time that any members of the weaker sex had participated in this work. I love that. It's just amazing, you know. Today, that patronizing observation has been replaced with a policy handed down by the federal government, and this has been since 1994. Every single study that the National Institutes of Health or the Centers for Disease Control, any study that they support, any research, at least half of the participants have to be women. So it's really shifted in terms of work. The Women's Health Initiative, which has been with tens of thousands of women, has been going on around heart disease and estrogen replacement therapy. So a lot is being done in this field. The Go Red campaign by the American Heart Association, it's in its second year. And what's amazing is in February, during the Heart Health Month, they had 1 billion media impressions around their Go Red campaign, which is great. And I met with the executive director a few weeks ago in Dallas. And what I was trying to talk to her about, though, is, you know, even though you had 1 billion media impressions, still most of the doctors, when women or male doctors, it doesn't matter. The research shows us it doesn't matter. When women come to an emergency room, they're still being turned away or told they have indigestion. Most women do not know their risks of heart disease, and yet the chronic disease in which the knowing your risk with some algorithms, and we have a whole chapter on here about risk, it's the most precise and probably the best in terms of your future prediction of having heart disease risk. Most women have never had one of these done in their physician's office. And, the breast cancer advocates are so much more ahead of the heart disease. And what I really want to do is get the diseases to stop fighting against each other And actually, if we just promoted, we got everybody more physically active and eating better, breast cancer, all the chronic diseases, heart disease, everything would be so much better. So I can rant and rave. So I will stop for a second. But there's a couple other quotes in here that I wanted to just do, and then I'll talk generally about nutrition and physical activity. This is chapter 8, relaxing, taking a deep breath, and other approaches. There's some other historical things. The Bible itself makes reference to it. When Jacob heard that his son Joseph had been alive the entire 22 years he had been missing in Egypt, his heart fell from the shock. Biblical scholars have interpreted it to mean that he suffered a heart attack. Interesting quote. Several studies have spotlighted anger in women. Including one from the University of North Carolina. Researchers there gave an anger test to some 13,000 people, asking them whether they had tended to fly off the handle, say unkind things when angry, or become furious when slowed down by others. We can all think of times like this. The higher they scored on the anger scales, the more likely they were to suffer from heart problems down the line. In fact, the most anger-prone people had nearly a threefold greater risk of suffering a heart attack or dying from heart disease than those with a longer fuse. So those are just a few of my favorite little quotes from the book. I have to just mention Alice. She was hoping to be here today, but she couldn't make it. But Alice is, the reason that we wrote this book was, this is actually my seventh in the series, and Alice is, Alice Lichtenstein, is chair of the American Heart Association's Committee on Nutrition, and she's really one of the world's most preeminent nutritionists in women and heart disease. And we're close colleagues, and we have been for two decades at Tufts. And she grabbed me in the hall one time and she said, "I just don't get it." She said, "If you think about the leading cause of death in women, heart disease kills about 500,000 a year, women a year, and you think about the greatest impact in terms of nutrition and physical activity on a chronic disease is heart disease. I can't believe you haven't done Strong Women, Strong Hearts." And I said, "Well, Alice, you know, I'm not about to write that book because that's your book to write, because she really is the preeminent, I mean, and she's a close colleague, and I'm not about to step on her toes." And she just said, "I'm not going to write a book on my own. I'm just not going to do it." And she said, "We're going to lunch." And I said, it's kind of tricky now that I have this series. It's not all that easy to collaborate all the time. And so she said, I don't want my picture on the front. I don't want any of that stuff. I just want to get this message out there." And we had the best time putting this book together. It was a real collaboration. So I just wanted to mention a little bit about Alice. There are a couple of things that are interesting around risk factors. We all know about cholesterol level and blood pressure, and this is similar for men and for women in terms of major risk factor for heart disease. But one thing that's not very well understood in the public eye, and I will also say it's still controversial because we just don't have the hundreds of thousands of data points like they have with cholesterol and blood pressure, is around fitness levels and the risk for future heart attacks. Now, what I'm talking about is not how much do you exercise each week, but actually how fit are you? If I get you and I do walking, if I take you out to the track at the Emerson Playground and I do an actual 12-minute walk test on you, how fit are you? What's the category? With the data with women, and to some extent with men, is that their fitness level is a more important risk factor, a predictor of future heart disease risk, than actually cholesterol and blood pressure, which the American Heart Association actually doesn't really, they're not buying into it yet. They buy into the physical activity is important, but one of the problems, as you can imagine, when you start thinking about fitness level, is that a physician can't put a cuff around an arm and do a fitness test. You can't draw blood and do a fitness test. You can't actually even, although it's somewhat related, you can't even ask a person how much do you exercise. That's an important question to ask, but in fact, that measurement is not that easy for a physician to get. So this is going to take, actually, I think, a long time for it to become part of the medical screening, if it ever does. The good news here is actually that you can do a fitness test on yourself. We go through a very simple 12-minute fitness test. Basically, just need to warm up. You need to know how long that track is. And you need to then have a paper and a pencil. If you went out with a friend, it'd be great. And you basically do a stopwatch and you see how far you can get in 12 minutes. And then you count the distance. And then that categorizes you into either, I think we tried to be nice about it, but our categories were superior, excellent, good, fair, poor, and very poor. To give you a sense, a woman that is, let's say my age, right, 40 to 49, I would be considered to be in fair physical fitness if I could walk about a 12-minute mile. So it's pretty rigorous. Now the good news is, in fact, that unlike cholesterol and blood pressure, which are not that easy to budge, fitness level, I tell you, you just start walking and your fitness level soars, and then if you add any kind of pace to that, your fitness, so it's, your fitness level is actually much more under your control than genetic factors are, which some of the others are much more under genetic factors. So from the fitness, from the risk factor perspective, we feel that the data is very much supports this fitness measurement as well. You've probably also heard a lot of information lately about homocysteine and C-reactive protein. There's LP, little p. I mean, there's all these different things that. Hi, Martha. Hi, Jody. Have a seat, please. There. Here you go. Down in front, right here. The reality about these other measurements is that it with women with C-reactive protein, which is a marker of inflammation, which is a pretty strong predictor of risk for men, it's not showing up nearly as strong for women. And some of this is there's a lot of variation in inflammation. You have a cold, you go out and exercise hard, you are fighting an infection. There are many different reasons why inflammation can go up, but it's not, C-reactive protein is not that strong a risk factor for women. Homocysteine, which is a, it's mostly a nutritional marker of your intake of B vitamins, especially B6, B12, and folate. And individuals that have high levels of homocysteine have low intake of these B vitamins, from mostly from fruits and vegetables. And they do have a greater risk, especially for stroke, cognitive impairment, and heart disease. With women, it's still showing that it's pretty predictive, but the thing with all these other risk factors is that still, if you look at smoking, blood pressure, total cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, HDL cholesterol, and you look at fitness, those are really, it explains so much of future risk. So that I'm not sure, I think there's a big market and there's a lot of business around all these other blood markers. I'm not convinced that the data supports them yet. In terms of nutrition, both Alice and I are nutritionists, and it's always fascinating being a nutritionist and reading the newspapers. You can imagine all the different conflicting reports that are out there. The cocktail parties that you go to and the questions that are asked of you. And what's fascinating about nutrition and heart disease is there is a lot that you can do to minimize your risk and to improve heart health through nutrition. But the most important thing is that it's not one single food, and it's the whole pattern of foods that you eat. Currently, the Food and Drug Administration has actual health claims that can go on certain foods around being heart healthy. So oats, olive oil, walnuts, and soy. And there may be a couple others, but I know at least those four. Now, what's very interesting is actually the data is not going to hold up, we know, for the soy. And I'll talk about that, why. But the data, that's going to be taken away at some point in the near future. But if you have a lousy diet and you have some walnuts, doesn't do anything. because it's the whole diet. It's like hitting a Mack truck, you know, it just doesn't do anything. If you have a lousy diet and you have a little bit of olive oil on your salad dressing, it doesn't do anything. So it is actually within the whole spectrum of what you're eating. And what we did put together was a nutrition program in here that's very much around a pattern of eating. And what I like about it is that we were able to get it down to a nice, a very simple way to think about it. And then we give very specifics. But so it's around the HEART acronym. Keep on vegetables and fruits, and you'll know that vegetables is before fruits. They're both important, but vegetables are lower in calorie than fruits are. Latest research from a very large study called the DASH study really shows it's actually about 7 to 9 vegetables and fruits a day that are it's the most heart healthy pattern of eating. But we, with women, because of caloric intake, we adjusted it to at least 5 or more vegetables and fruits a day. Emphasize the right fats. So the thing about heart health is actually a moderately fat diet, so somewhere around 30 to 35%, is very heart healthy as long as it's the right oils. And this is where I think the policymakers and then, you know, went awry 30 years ago, because we had a very high fat diet. And we thought that was the cause of heart disease. And so the fat went down in the diet, and it did. And what replaced it were all these really, frankly, crappy carbohydrates. These highly, you know, palatable, very processed white carbohydrates. And I can get into that in a bit. But right now, the carbohydrates are getting the bad rap. And so everybody wants to throw out the carbohydrates. Well, it's just like the fats. Don't throw out the fats. It's get the right complement. So we're talking about corn oil, soybean oil, canola oil, olive oil, trying to minimize, if you have high cholesterol level, minimizing the saturated fats that are coming from fatty meats, very high fat dairy foods, and from too much butter. And Alice and I had a constant argument for a year while we were writing that. I'm like, but you gotta have a little butter, you gotta have a little butter. And she's, well, it depends. And you know, the issue is you can have a little bit of butter. It's just, it's not when you're having pancakes, it's not a tablespoon. It's a little bit that's okay. So accentuate whole grains. The average woman right now is getting about 1 whole grain a day, and that's usually her breakfast cereal. Should have at least 3 whole grain servings, and I'm talking about 100% whole wheat bread, full oat kind of oats and oat cereal, brown rice. Minimizing the processed grains that you're getting. The data from the Nurses' Health Study and from this DASH diet and from everywhere else shows that this pattern of lots of vegetables and fruits, whole grains, and then and low and non-fat dairy foods is really a pattern that is good for basically all chronic disease conditions, but especially around blood pressure, cholesterol level. And so revere low and non-fat dairy foods, at least 2 to 3 servings, preferably 3, and target heart-healthy proteins. So these are lean meats. It's also around fish. The data on fish is fascinating, and Alice is really a fish aficionado, and has been on a number of different trials where they've actually been doing fish meals, and they've seen that when women have at least 2 to 3 fish meals a week, and what's interesting, it doesn't matter. It's preferably at least 3 if it's the white fish, and 2 if it's a cold water fish. But what we say is basically any fish, 2 to 3 times a week, not batter dipped and deep fried, but broiled or baked or grilled, that actually reduces the progression of heart disease and atherosclerosis within the vasculature, and also reduces your future risk of heart attacks. So the right kinds of proteins. So when you think about this pattern of eating, and I love eating, I love good food, it is really about, at breakfast, it's not a white bagel that's 5 servings of refined grain. It is a whole grain cereal with some low-fat milk or yogurt with some cut-up fruit on top, And then lunch is, you know, a whole grain, 100% whole grain bread with some lean turkey or tuna and an apple or some vegetables and a salad. Snack is going to be vegetables or fruit or low-fat dairy. And then a dinner is going to be some lean meat with a little bit of starch, hopefully like brown rice or some whole grain. Wonderful. I have a wonderful recipe, and we put it in here. I got permission. One of my favorite whole grain recipes is a wheat berry recipe. It's a wheat berry salad. I don't know, how many of you have had wheat berries lately? I mean, it's a very kind, it's not a grain that people eat very often, and yet it's like my children's favorite side dish, and it's amazing. And it's with pine nuts and dried cranberries, and wheat berry, it's a real whole grain. It just takes a long time to cook. It takes a couple hours to cook, but you sort of put it in the oven and you forget it, or put it on the stove and you forget about it, and a couple hours later it's all ready. So anyway, whole grain dinner with some salad and a vegetable and a little bit of dessert, and that's what the pattern is. And a lot of people say, boy, that sounds great, that's the way I eat anyway. But if you keep a food record, you find out there's all this other insensible stuff that's sort of infiltrating your diet, and sort of the snacking and this and that, and I'll get into this a little bit with the weight control. But it is really, it's a whole foods pattern of eating that is, and it's wholesome and it tastes good, but it doesn't have a lot of like butter and cream. In terms of cholesterol level, that's very important. Occasionally it can. Now with fitness, the program that we put together in here is a very stepwise program, and it's really around aerobic exercise and also strengthening exercises. Another colleague at Tufts did a study in which I collaborated on. Her name is Dr. Sheffa, and it was a study with type 2 diabetics. And type 2 diabetics are obviously at a much greater risk for heart disease than individuals who don't have diabetes. And this group was average age of 66, and it was a 16-week trial in which it was randomized controlled. Half the group strength trained for three times a week for 16 weeks, and the other was in a usual care group. And what we saw in this group was a reduction in systolic blood pressure, a gain in skeletal muscle, and a reduction especially in abdominal fat. So we have ways we can measure different body compartments and different areas of fat. Actually, they lost over a pound of abdominal fat, which is the fat that you don't want in terms of heart disease and type 2 diabetes. 72% of the exercisers actually needed to reduce their diabetes medication. And also there's a marker called hemoglobin A1C, or glycosylated hemoglobin, which is a long-term marker of glucose control, and that went down by about 13%. So when you think about reducing heart disease risk, the strength training seems to be very positive in terms of improving body composition and heart disease risk. So the combination of both strength for women and men, and aerobic activity seems to really be the right combination. Then we also, because 65% of the U.S. population is overweight or obese, we very much mind the research in terms of long-term strategies for weight control. And you picked up on one of them earlier. And because if you are overweight, you don't die of being overweight. You actually die of complications. And a person who's overweight or obese has a six-fold increase of dying from heart disease. So it's a huge elevated risk, and especially for type 2 diabetes and heart disease. But we did it. There's a chapter in here which is 10 strategies, we call it the, I put in the tough, because I think anytime you're losing weight, it's tough. But 10 tough strategies for weight loss. And what we did was, again, we looked at the research that's out there and put together this chapter. And you might be surprised, because a lot of this is actually not about what to eat, but it's around the culture of nutrition. So first thing is, you actually need to know what you need to lose. And I tell you, so much of the time, I'm amazed when I talk to women and their body mass index, which is their height for weight, is in, maybe it's in the high normal range, or it's in some range, and they just, they are totally off on actually what they need to lose. It's some preconceived weight that they had when they were 18 years old, before they had four kids, you know, and now they're 55. You've got to be smart about the strategy of how much you need to lose. So the 10 strategies are: believe you can lose weight and commit to making the necessary changes and plan for it. Believing in yourself, and I've been, you know, Red Sox Nation, believing is very important. And it really works. The data shows that the women in different research studies, that if they believe they're going to lose weight, the women that believe lose about 50% more than the women who don't believe. So, and planning for it is very important. So that positive outlook. The average person, actually this is from the National Weight Control Registry data, the average person, it takes them about 4 to 6 times to actually lose the weight and keep it off permanently. So it's just like smoking cessation. Number 2, write down everything that you eat. I can tell you a lot of people just go, there's just no way. But there's some very fascinating study that was done by Kaiser Permanente out in California, where it was a randomized controlled trial, and half the people were put into a behavior modification program where they were given lots of instruction and training, and there was a nutritionist and an exercise physiologist and everything. And another group, you just have to write down everything that you eat, not even the whole recipe, just what you eat, when you eat it, and where you eat it, and how much physical activity. And the group that just wrote everything down without any counseling lost more weight. So the writing stuff down makes you accountable. You all of a sudden see, man, I had a half a bag of chips. I can't believe I had a half a bag of, you know, chips. You start being really accountable for what you're doing, and you start to be your own trainer. Commit to breakfast. The research around breakfast is fascinating, and it shows that actually women who have a decent breakfast, again, this is not a piece of toast and a cup of coffee, but some whole grain cereal, some low-fat milk, some cut-up fruit, or an egg, and on toast, something that has some protein, a fruit, and some grain, generally, or dairy, that those individuals tend to eat fewer calories throughout the 24-hour period. There's something anthropological that is hardwired in us to help regulate satiety if we have some breakfast in the morning. So commit to breakfast. That's number 3. Number 4, and this is where I can start to rant and rave again, is eat only at a table designated for dining, whether it's your kitchen, dining room, or office, without the television on. Now, when you eat dinner with a TV on, the average individual, with the research that's been done, the average individual eats more calories if the television is on than if it's off. There's, again, some anthropological, you know, hardwired piece in our brains that when there's other sensory information coming in that's not very, it's not two-way, it's not engaging, that we'll just sit there and we'll just eat away and we don't get full. So, and I know this is very tough for, especially for individuals who are single or don't have their family members around. And what I say is, make a little bit of a ceremony around it. If you have a nice book, or you have a magazine, or you have letters or something, but sit at the dining room table, not without the television on, have your meal, finish, then if you want to go watch a television show, that's fine. But it actually limits the amount of calories that you eat. This also gets to the fact that for many, the car has become the dining room for many, and the car should not be the dining room. Walking down the street should not be the dining room. Your office desk should not be the dining room. There is this degradation in the way that we eat, the mindful eating and the family meal and the gathering around a table, that's really been lost. And this really contributes, all the data with children that don't have a family meal, and it can just be with one person, but children that don't have a family meal are much greater increased risk of childhood obesity than those children who actually, where the family eats together. And again, getting at the television with children, a close colleague of mine that I work with at Tufts, who also lives here in Concord, Chris Konomos, been doing a lot of work with after-school programs and also in-school programs. And in Massachusetts, about 45% of first, second, and third graders have a television in their bedroom. And In New York, with some WIC participants, some children, it was about 30% of one-year-old, two- and three-year-olds already have a television in their bedroom. And these television in children's bedroom is just awful, because what happens is they get snacked, they're bombarded by commercials, and then it's very sedentary, and then they just sit and eat. And so, and then they're not very active. Now, I can see why it happens. You have a perfectly good TV in your living room, and the next thing you know, you're getting a new one, and well, you're not going to throw this one out, so where are you going to put it? Because you already have one in your bedroom. You're going to put it in the kids' room. Don't put a television in the kid room. And if you can limit the house to one television, also very important if you can. Okay, I can't rant and rave about that anymore. But so if you think about I'm going to say one other thing. If you think about smoking cessation, which many of you probably have never gone through, but the smoking cessation data, a lot of it is about limiting, coming up with rules of when you can smoke and when you can't. It actually ends up limiting the number of cigarettes you're getting over the day. A lot of this eating only at a table that's designed for eating is limiting those insensible snacks and limiting those, in the car, that kind of snacking. Snacking's fine, I'll get to that in a minute. Number five, I'm not a really tough mother either, I promise. I sound like I'm a hard-nosed mother, I'm not, but set a kitchen close time. After dinner, you should actually close down the kitchen. You know, that's it. You have dinner, you have a little dessert, but there's no more eating after dinner. The research around individuals who are overweight and obese, there's indication that they eat the same amount of calories through dinner, and then they're getting more calories later on in the evening. Many of them are. So again, and if you think about the calories that are coming in after dinner, they aren't carrots and hummus. They're usually brownies and ice cream and cookies, and they're really, which again, a little bit is fine, but it's not just sort of the half a gallon of ice cream. So have a kitchen close time and stick to it. Be extra vigilant, this is number six, about foods that you haven't prepared yourself. 50% of Americans eat out every day, some meal, and we've got a massive restaurant intervention actually going on in Somerville right now that's been really fascinating to understand around restaurants. But one of the things that we all need to start doing, and if you start doing it more, restaurants will start to change, is if you know that the restaurant serves large portions, which almost all of them do, you say, would you mind, before you bring the meal to me, if you could cut everything in half and put it all, half of it all in a doggy bag, I'd like to just have a plate with half of it. And the people, kind of look at you like you're crazy, or we'd like to split it, or I'd like to have half the potato and twice the vegetable, or half the beef or meat or pork or whatever it is, chicken, and twice the vegetable. Would you like rice with that? Please, I'd love rice with that, but do you have brown rice? And actually, it's amazing, like Chang'an's, if you ask, they have brown rice. I think enough people have been asking for it. So some restaurants actually have it, but if you start asking for it more, all of these things, rolls, I'd love some rolls, but do you have 100% whole grain, or do you have whole grain rolls? If we start asking more as a culture, we create this movement, things will start happening, I think, around it. But it's hard to eat out and not get too many calories. With the portion sizes, the research is fascinating because they've done studies where they bring out a large portion, or they tell the other group that with small portions, a smaller plate and smaller portion, you can have as much as you want. Everybody can have as much as they want. The people that are served the smaller plates and the smaller portion always eat less than the people are served the large portion on the larger plates. So again, we are so hardwired to withstand starvation, so we're always, our bodies, there's some kind of tug. We just always want to be a little extra nourished than we need to be. So you've really got to work hard around this. All right, so number seven, don't drink your calories. I'm sorry for all those latte fans, but there was a study, very interesting study done with giving individuals unlimited amount of soda, which is just pure sugar, or unlimited amount of jelly beans, good quality jelly beans, which are pure sugar. And the people that were given the jelly beans ate fewer calories than drinking the sodas. And we, again, we don't perceive liquid calories to nearly the same extent as we do foods that we eat, that we actually chew and we eat and we swallow. So if weight control is an issue, if you absolutely just cut out every beverage that has calories, except for maybe a glass of low-fat milk, which is some evidence that might be beneficial for long-term weight control, but if you cut out all those sodas, fruit drinks, they say 100% fruit, but actually they're really pure sugar, basically, a lot of these. The sports drink, unless you're really running a marathon or doing stuff in the really hot weather for a long period of time, there is no need for sports drinks, despite what everybody might think from looking at the commercials. Water, tea, coffee, a teaspoon of sugar is 14 calories, inconsequential. So, you know, that's fine. It's just that the lattes and the mocha lattes, which have 200 to 400 calories in them, are just not the right way to go. Number 8, eat grains, but make them whole grains. If you actually switch every one of your grains to 100% whole grains, you'll probably lose weight. We did a study at Tufts at one point where we switched everybody. It was a very high fiber diet where all the grains were whole grains. Immediately, they couldn't eat the whole meal. They just got full so fast, and yet they were giving them the same amount of calories. So switch, and I talked about whole grains earlier. Snacking smart, for those of you who work and you get, you have lunch at noon and you're not gonna have dinner until 7:30, you gotta have some snack, but the vending machine is generally not your best bet. This is a perfect time for fruit, for cut up vegetable, for low fat yogurt. I mean, I find yogurt lasts me a long time. Having something that has a little bit of staying power, some almonds or nuts or walnuts, even though they may be higher in calories, you gotta be a little bit careful on how many of them you eat. They're a much better bet than a large candy bar or a big bag of chips, things like that. And then obviously 10 is to move your body. You just have to move. Now, in terms of trying to get more physical activity into your life, there are many different ways to think about this. You certainly can join a fitness facility. You can go out and walk or jog or run yourself. But you can also try to figure it out in your everyday life about commuting. I live just about a mile and a half out of town, and we are lucky. We do have a sidewalk all the way to our house. And you know, many times, you know, we might need a little bit of milk or some orange juice or something. Like, I'll just get on my bike with a little backpack because I realize I'm going to get a nice, 15-minute bike ride by just zipping into town and out, and I don't have to deal with the car. Trying to figure out ways to, or you're at one friend's house and you're going home, let your husband drive the car and you can walk home. I mean, there's lots of ways, but you have to be just a little bit conscious about it. And if you work, I work where there's lots of steps instead of taking the elevator. I've been in the building now 2.5 years, and I was trying to count up the other day about how many times I thought I'd use the elevator. I'm only on the second floor, so it's pretty easy, but it's still a real pain because the staircase is way around and it's not very convenient. But I think in 2 years I've probably taken it maybe 20 times, and that's been because I had massive number of bags and I was traveling and trying to get through all the heavy fire doors with the stairs, I couldn't do it. But you can start getting that into your life. But at some point, what I say is you have to make that conscious decision. You just have to have, like, the switch. And you probably all experience with some behavior, like the switch just has to go off. And there's some other ways for sort of what we call self-monitoring. I really do, if you're a walker, I love the pedometers. And what the pedometers will do is give you a sense of how much you have been walking. Some people that live in the city, I was just with some friends not too long ago, and she said, I just walk everywhere and I just don't know if I'm getting enough physical activity. It's like, you get a pedometer. You're doing 10,000 steps, you're getting a lot. And that's a great number to be striving towards, is about 10,000 steps. You may find you're only getting about 3,000 steps to begin with. Then you want to try over time to add another 1,000 steps, if you can, each day, or at least like every other day to try to get that up there. A couple other things around physical activity. If you can, there is a lot of benefit for intensity for your heart. If you can break a sweat a couple times, even though for some of you, you may never have done this and it's not very ladylike, to break a sweat a couple times a week around getting your heart rate up, not just because it's warm up, but getting your heart rate up to a level in which you're actually perspiring. That intensity, if you think about it, your heart is a muscle, and if you engage it, it's going to adapt to what it's being asked to do over time. So if you never push it, it's just going to slowly sort of not be as efficient as it used to be. But if you keep continually pushing it, you're going to keep it much healthier. The data with masters athletes is fascinating. This is where I wish I had a graph, because your fitness level does go down as you grow older. But if you are sedentary, the data is, if you can just watch me for a second. So let's say you're sedentary and your fitness level, you're 20 years old and your fitness level is up here. And as you grow older, your fitness level is going to drop. A lot of that is because of something we can't change, and that's your maximal heart rate goes down as you grow older. And if your heart rate goes down, your pumping capacity is going to go down to some extent. So this is the sedentary individual, 20 to 80. Well, in fact, the person who is active over time, and there's wonderful data, the active people are up here on the fitness level, so that the 60-year-old is like the 20-year-old. Mm-hmm. So this is where it's important. Yes, it's going to go down, but it's a whole step up that's so much different. So the fact that there are, you know, there's 70 and 80-year-old women and men now doing close to 4-hour marathons, and yet many 20-year-old, you know, individuals could never do that. So it shows you, my newest model that I love very much is age matters less, it's what you do that counts. Every study that we've done, that others have done, keeps showing that yes, age is always a, what we call a covariate or a confounding factor in our research, but by far the biggest one is their fitness level, their nutrition, their outlook, positive outlook. All of those factors are much more important than just age. And you know what? That's great, because we're not going to change age. I mean, and it's just going to march along. And a funny aside is I do a lot of interviews, as you can imagine, and sometimes I get these people and they call me up and they want to talk to an anti-aging expert. and I go, wow, man, you've really got the wrong person, because I am what I would call a pro-aging. And they go, huh? What do you mean by pro-aging expert? Well, I said, I really do want to grow old. I mean, I see it as a goal. I mean, I have a 90-year-old father-in-law right now, and it's just, you know, that's what I want. I want to grow old, and I want to do it in a very a pro fashion and look positively about it. This anti-thought, I think, is a very negative sort of ageism piece. Now I'm getting off task. But anyway, I just think that that's a really important way to be thinking about how you grow older. Couple little things that I'd love to encourage you to do is to go to my website, which is strongwomen.com. There's a lot of information there, a free newsletter, monthly newsletter. It's not, we don't sell the newsletter list at all. It's very highly protected. It goes out every month. And then also we do, I help to host a number of Strong Women Summits. We're doing one actually next weekend in New Jersey, and then we've got another one in New York in the fall, and one in California, so if you know of anybody. And I think that's about it in terms of some of the other opportunities to have a lot of fun with a lot of strong women, and we really love good, strong, decent men as well. So behind every strong woman is a good, decent man. So, but I'm happy right now to answer some questions, and then I can sign some books. Yeah,
Are resistance machines or repetition machines be just as good to use?
Absolutely,
as weights,
great.
If you don't do well with weights.
Yes, I my preference. If you asked me, if you said I'm equal about doing this at home or community center, I'd love to get everybody in a fitness center if I could. And in the fitness center, there's going to be machines, there's going to be instruction. Bless you. I think it's excellent. So if you like that, it's excellent. There is still, there's a different benefit from free weights, because you actually have to think more about where your body is in space as opposed to being set. And there's a whole different mindfulness that comes with free weights, but they all have their benefits.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It's all well and good if you can do this, but if you physically, you can't do a mile in 12 minutes, it's just, at least I can't do it anymore. But what I try and do is I do 10 minutes and I have to rest because of my knee, and then I try another 10 minutes and walk.
Well, but you're absolutely right. The fitness test I'm talking about is just, it's an actual fitness test.
I used to be able to do it.
To get you to monitor yourself. But it's also age dependent, so don't fret. And the other thing is that in terms of when you're actually going out for a walk, if you can do it in 5-minute bouts, 10 minutes, whatever you can do, that's great. And resting, it doesn't matter. You can do a 10-minute bout, rest, 10-minute bout. That's a perfect way to do it. It doesn't matter. It's much more just about getting your heart rate up for a sustained amount of time, which it sounds like you're doing. So that's great. It's fabulous. Other questions about nutrition, physical activity?
Yeah. Yeah.
When you say the amounts of vegetables and fruits, 5 to 7, what is the serving size? It sounds like an awful lot.
Serving size, a half a banana is a fruit. Depending on the size of the orange, orange can be either a whole serving. If it's smaller, like a clementine, is going to be one, whereas a big navel orange might be two. Vegetables, a cut up, cooked, is a half. If it is green leafy, like raw, like spinach or lettuce, it's a cup to 2 cups, depends, as a serving. A grain is a half a cup of rice is a serving. So gives you a sense.
Yeah,
it's actually, it's still a lot. I tell you, it's my single, I have no problem with whole grains. I have no problem with proteins and things like, my biggest problem is it's vegetables and fruits. And I think some of it is just, it's a convenience thing, because, you know, breakfast, I get my cereal and I have my orange juice because I have my fresh squeezed orange. But then lunch, it depends on what's being served at our little cafeteria, so sometimes I get them. So it's more of a convenience thing. But it's still, it's hard. I think it's hard. If you write things down, you might be surprised at how few fruits and vegetables and fruits you're getting every day. But if you remember, if you're adding, you got to subtract something. You can't just keep adding different things. I mean, I talk about whole, so don't keep your same diet and add, you know, 2 more whole grain servings and 3 more fruits without trying to decrease some of the other things that don't quite fit into the pattern, if you can. Yeah.
Are all fruits and vegetables equally nutrition depending upon how they're grown?
Well, mostly. I am a very big advocate of organic. But I'll tell you, the organic food, when they've done the like pure amount of vitamin C or whatever nutrients they're looking, generally it's the same as when it's done with conventional methods. But what we don't necessarily know is all the different phytochemicals, the other things that we can't measure very well. And then I just, from a purely environmental standpoint, I just really advocate either locally grown stuff or organic.
You can ask a follow-up.
Mm-hmm.
As fresh produce
mm-hmm.
should age, other than the fact that it may not taste that good, mm-hmm. is it still nutritious when you eat it?
It depends.
It's
actually, vitamin C levels will go down. I think riboflavin, if it's been in the sun, will go down a little bit. They actually will go down a bit. And this is why, actually, in the winter especially, I mean, in the summer, I really advocate trying to get fresh fruits and vegetables. But in the winter, frozen vegetables may be, because they are flash frozen, you know, they generally come off and they are frozen very quickly the way they process these. You may actually, frozen or fresh is really just fine in terms of the nutrients. Yeah.
What were you going to say about soy?
Oh, soy. So, I'm glad you asked that. So historically, what they've seen is that individuals that have a lot of soy in their diet had lower blood pressure, lower cholesterol levels. There was some early work done with soy that looked like it actually did help to reduce cholesterol levels. The problem with it is, and this is where I want to be, try to be as clear as I can and if not ask a follow-up, is that if you think about it, think about soy protein. It doesn't have saturated fat that's attached to it. And you take any other high-protein thing, it has some saturated fat. Generally, beef, pork, even chicken, they're going to have some saturated fat. So what happened was when they took out, like, the, you know, beef or pork, and they added in the soy, the saturated fats in that pattern of eating went down. So Alice, actually, did the definitive study where they matched the fatty acid, the fat content of the diet and the type of oils, and they just substituted literally soy protein for beef protein or pork protein or egg and different. And in fact, there's nothing magical about soy protein. It's just, so there's nothing magical about it except that in nature there is something magical about it because it doesn't have a lot of the saturated. So if you're eating tofu or soybeans in some casserole or something like, or miso soup, things like that, you know, it just doesn't have a lot of the saturated fat. So it's a great protein. It's just that it's protein itself. It's not exceptionally heart healthy. It is just because of the way it's packaged in nature, if you get what I'm saying. So that's why the FDA approval for it being called a heart healthy protein, well, it's actually not correct anymore. It's not bad because it is, it's fine. It's just fine. I'm not an advocate of isoflavones and all these other protein supplements. I think that there may end up being just as much adverse events with it. I'm a whole foods. Glucose allows the glucose to go from the outside of the cells into the cells, but there are also things we would call non-insulin dependent glucose transporters. Which in fact, so everybody always thinks you gotta have insulin, but in fact there are a lot of other transporters that take glucose from the bloodstream and take it into the muscle cells that don't need insulin, and when you exercise, those are upregulated too. Aging, genetics, but there's a fair amount that you can do around fasting blood glucose with physical activity, with not having a really high carbohydrate diet. So this is where the low-fat diets are not the greatest things for people who are at risk, because you have a lot more carbohydrates, you actually get higher triglycerides, which are another fatty acid, which I haven't talked about, and you get into this metabolic syndrome, which is large abdominal waist, high fasting blood glucose, high triglycerides, and that's really indicative of, there's some genetic factors, but poor diet that's not rich in fruits, vegetables, whole grains, the lean meats or lean proteins, and lack of physical activity is a big one here. Reassessing short-term goals and goal setting is a really important one to think about. Too many people have goals that are related to, I'm going to lose 20 pounds by Christmas, or it's around weight. The goal should always be around behaviors that you know you actually can control. My goal is that this month, every week, I'm going to get out and exercise 3 or 4 times. If you have goals that are around behaviors, then you're more beholden to it than other things that are hard to control.